My title show, we're going to be talking about the Elliptic Accelerate Training Platform. I am going to apologise now, there is a lot of overlap with what Terry's just spoken about, so I'll probably skip through those slides and not really lean on them too much. I'll also be talking about Elixir Test for about one slide, but again, I'm not going to go too much into that because I don't want to steal the thunder of Niall. So, I'm Louisa and I work at the University of Cambridge, and I was hired as part of the Elixir Accelerate grant last August to be their training quality and impact coordinator. But for the last 2 months, I've been working with the training platform as a temporary interim training platform coordinator before we hire someone more permanently. So for those of you who don't know a lot about the background of Elixir, I've just got a couple of slides about what we do. So Elixir, as Terry said, was developed in about 2013 to create a distributed European infrastructure for biological research data. Now it is European, so all of our nodes are in Europe, however that doesn't mean that we don't then collaborate with people all over the world, and it also does not mean that we don't just train people from Europe, we do train anyone who wants to be trained. So the nodes themselves build local bioinformatics capacity throughout Europe. So what we've done is each node has been chosen for a reason, and they have a resource or more than one resource, and Elixir helps them to build on those resources, connect with each other, and provide training for people who need it. So we currently have 21 nodes, and that includes MLEBI, which although it is in the UK, it is seen as a separate entity. So it's a node in itself. So we have 21 nodes, and we have one observer. And the observer is, as you can see, is Greece, and it may be that they become a full member in the future, but that's something that's still under discussion at the moment. Elixir Accelerate was developed in about 2015, and it was to accelerate the implementation of Elixir across the nodes. And one part of this, as I've got this big circle, is training. So we really wanted to boost the training across the nodes because it wasn't just enough that we had the resources, we wanted people to be trained on them. Another section of this training was the quality and impacts that we wanted to focus on a bit more. And the reason for the quality and impact is that it wasn't just enough that we wanted to provide training, we needed to make sure that there was training, we needed to make sure that the training was of a standard across all the nodes. And that's where I come in. And we wanted to focus on four use cases, which are below. So the training aspect of it, we wanted to create an interactive Elixir-wide training community, and we wanted to build on and complement what was already being provided in the nodes. And the training infrastructure that was then developed incorporated the test portal, which advertised the events, and also collated the materials for some of the events. We also have e-learning, which I think might be useful or might be interesting to today, because we're hoping in the future, it's still quite new, the e-learning collects YouTube videos of each of the courses, it also collects the materials, so that's something that could potentially be extracted and put into Erudite. We have the virtual coffee room, which is mostly at the moment for developers, and I'll talk about that in a minute. And then we have training events. So as Terry mentioned, she has training the high school teacher, we have train the trainer, train the researcher, and train the developer events. And then lastly, the thing that I'm interested in the most is the quality and impact of each training event. This is a picture that you saw before from Jack. So this just shows that within Elixir, although we are European, we do have external collaborations with consortiums all over the world, and this is really important because we're not just our own entity, we need to be able to branch out and interact with other people. And you can see that we also, we are linked down here to Cobell and our right train, and we've added Fire Excel to this since your picture. So the train platform at the moment, and the external collaborations that we have ongoing, we have one with Edison. So at the moment we're looking at mapping the courses to the core competencies, with the joint workshop hopefully being planned, I believe, for this summer. We're working with yourselves to look at collaborations on the training portals. With Goblet, we're looking at working with you for the trainer activities. And again, as you mentioned, the training accreditation. And just to talk about that for 1 second, I used to work at Emberley BI before I came to Elixir. And I remember the training accreditation being talked about back at the start, because a lot of the students, and especially at the University of Cambridge where I work, they always want some sort of certificate at the end of their courses, whether to prove they've attended it or for their own information for their CV. So I think this is something that would be really useful, and it would be great to have something that would be recognised across all sorts of courses and not just Goblet or Elixir. So Codata RDA, we're looking at collaborating with them for a data science summer school for this year. Data carpentry and software carpentry, we are hoping to provide, I believe, 40 events over the next year with these workshops. The agreement is in the signing phase at the moment, but slightly up in the air because we've had a change of leadership with that. And then with Galaxy, as we well know, not as we speak right now because it's 25 to 8 in the evening, but the workshop has just had its final day in the University of Cambridge. And when I left on Monday, everyone seemed quite happy and it seemed to be very well received, so I'll be able to see what the impact of that is when I get back. As I said, I'm only going to touch on this. So the Elixir training portal test, at the moment, I think, or the last time I checked, we had 230 upcoming events. Now, they're not just Elixir-based events, they are, I believe, just any informatics-type events that get dragged in, yeah. So we have 230 upcoming events. There are 657 training materials that are accessible and 38 content providers, and that includes 9 Elixir nodes. And this is the interface at the minute. And I'm quite excited to hopefully be working with Niall to curate some of the events that are on there to make them more easily findable. Going back to e-learning, we have got an e-learning strategy guidelines and recommendation white paper at the moment that was worked on in collaboration with Goblet. What I've done with this presentation, if we do send it around afterwards, I've made that as a hyperlink so that people can go straight to it and they can have a read. We've had, I believe, 7 e-learning events so far over the past year. It's still in its infancy, but it is starting to get there. And what we're hoping to do with each of the e-learning is record them all so that people can access them after the fact. The virtual coffee room was launched in March 2017 at the Elixir All Hands meeting. And this is seen, if you like, as a safe space for developers. And this is a place where people who have attended the developer courses can go to before or after their course and talk to other people in the same area. And they can ask questions, as you can see here, they can ask questions to each other and create an area where they can just collaborate. It may be that it's extended to not just developers in the future, but right now it's still quite new, but anyone can feel free to go to the link and have a look around, and I believe you can all get accounts as well. So part of the Elixir Accelerate was to deliver training to the Accelerate community, train the developer, train the trainer, and train the researchers were all developed because we realised that there was a gap in the training for this type of event. That it was good to create this really focused training event for people that looked at what they needed. Train the developer, I believe we've had about two events at the moment that are training the developer. We've had seven train the trainer, no, sorry, six train the trainer with one happening quite soon. And the reason we've developed these, especially train the trainer, is we train people at, no, we have lots of training events at the University of Cambridge. And a lot of the trainers themselves are PhD students, they're postdocs, and a lot of them don't have a background in training. So although they can be the most fantastic person, the most intelligent person in that field, they may not always have the skills to be able to pass that information along. And by providing training events such as Train the Trainer, it just gives them a little bit of a skill base to understand how to interact with their audience, how the slides could be created, and how to deal with feedback at the end. So they're really useful events to have, and we've currently held them in Italy, in Switzerland, and in the UK. And each time you can train up to, I think, 20 people at a time. So you get this lovely core set of trainers that all start at the on the same page, and they all understand what would be required of them. So we've also got training the researcher. So train the researcher, we're going to be looking at using that for the software and data carpentry, because not only do we want to have the normal software carpentry event, we also want to train some instructors as well. So, as I mentioned, this is what I'm most interested in, this is what I'm currently working on. And we need to, it's not only enough just to provide the events, it's not only enough to train the trainers for the events, we need to make sure that each of these training events is of good quality, has been carried out with good practice, and has impact in the short term and in the long term. So what we've done so far, it's only been going since August, we've got an initial mechanism to capture and report on the impact of the training programme. And also we provide guidance to each of the nodes on how to collect this information, what questions to use, what KPIs we want to collect, and also how to report it back to me. We also want to perform some gap analysis for industry needs, because we don't just want to keep up our training events sort of in-house with the institutions, with the universities. We want to be able to train and we want to attract people in industry as well. I'm currently working with somebody from industry who wants to train all of his work, well, not all of his workers, but the workers in one particular area of that company. He wants to give them all training on something similar to data carpentry so that they all understand how to deal with the research that they're working on so that they're all on the same page. So the KPIs that we are currently collecting is we're looking for participant numbers, gender, which I know is quite contentious, but the reason I'm pushing to collect genders because I want to show that we're not just training one gender over another, that we're not really attracting genders. And at the moment, we're looking at 56% that we've trained at the moment are female and 44% are male. A lot of people decline that question, and that's perfectly fine, I don't push it, but I do think it's quite interesting that we have this split. We also look at career level. And the reason we're looking at career level is because we want to know what career level somebody's at when they first come to training. And then when we contact them in 6 to 12 months' time, we want to know, have they progressed up in their career? Are they in exactly the same job? Have they moved sideways? Have they gone to a completely different industry altogether? And And then we link that with the impact of the training event that they attended to see if their training has actually helped them in their career or enhanced, or they've been able to train other people. We also look at employment sector, again that's coming back to industry, so we want to know that we're not just training PhD students or just postdocs or just staff. We want to see a good split of attendees. Country of employment as well. So this isn't the original country that somebody is from, it's where they are currently employed. And the reason I stress that is you'd be surprised how many people write that as their country of birth rather than their country of employment. And we've seen that for Elixir courses in places like Spain and the UK, people have travelled as far as the United States and Australia to actually attend those courses. Where did the participants see the event being advertised? Goes back to tests as well. So we want to see where people are looking for these events the most. And we currently have 20 whole people looking for tests. And I am actually really excited with that. Overall satisfaction of the entire course is something that's really important. And you'd be surprised how many existing surveys the nodes were using that didn't ask that. They just asked about each of the topics. And some of the topics may not have been to somebody's taste, but overall, they were really happy with the course, and I think that's why it's really important just to have this very simply, how happy were you with the course? And then we always ask about long-term feedback, so we're just in the stages now where we're going to start to look at contacting people for long-term feedback of courses that they attended between August and October of last year. So this is just a sample of the courses at the moment. So we have 9 nodes that have been able to send feedback back to me. Just over 100 events, just over 1,000 people trained in total. And you can see that the satisfaction is around 14% is excellent, with 73% being good. And then we have everything else. We ask people if they would recommend the course to their peers, and overridingly, yes, with a lot of people saying they might. And this might normally comes with a comment of, yes, I might, if they were interested in that topic. So I thought it's been quite interesting. We have the career stage in the lower left, and you can see that it's mostly made up of postdocs and PhD students, but we do have a fair chunk of people who are staff either at the University of Cambridge or externally, and principal investigators. And then this, I'll just use this, you turn it around the right way. So you have this 2.2% updated as of Monday is TET, that relates to 20, but mostly we have people using the host website, so either the University of Cambridge or if it's external, it will be the institute that's hosting that course. That's where most people find it, and then an email from their peers or an email that they've signed up to. Going back to the metadata standards that Terry was talking about, this is very similar to what was just mentioned, but we have a minimum set of descriptors that's currently currently under review by Elixir and Gobbler, with 3 hackathons that have taken place so far. So 2 hackathons were for the NGS training material creation, one in 2015, one in 2016. And you can find these curated materials either through TESS or through Gobbler portals, and they are also hosted on the GitHub website. We had one Elixir Gobbler hackathon for Galaxy training materials reusability. That was this week, Monday to Wednesday. And the descriptors were applied to existing sets of materials and were refined as needed. So hopefully there'll be a report on the hackathon that's happened this week in the next few months. Talking about competencies, in Elixir we do actually want to develop, refine and extend the current competencies for current and emerging fields. And we want to align with Corbell and RI Train and BioExcel to look at defining these core competencies. And we're using ISCB as a way to help us with that, to see what they've done, because they're currently refining their existing competencies that they published, I think in 2015-16. And I've worked alongside some people at Emily BI to look at each course and try to annotate them and link them to core competencies, and then we're hoping to do that with the University of Cambridge Bioinformatics Training as well. And then with Edison's also developing core competencies, and so we're looking at collaborating with them to create a workshop. So just to give you an example of what I mean, these are the core competencies that the ISCB created and published. I have put the link at the bottom, so when I send this around, you can all go to it. So that's what theirs looks like, and that's what we're hoping to do with our courses at the moment. And then the same with Edison. This was shamelessly taken from the slides that I found online from Yuri Demchenko. And I just took out this table, and this is how they're doing it. So they have the different levels of competency and what they expect each of those people to have on each level. So Elixir is currently exploring the possibility of putting a proposal together for an implementation study to cover the use of competencies to describe all the training events and learning paths. We definitely want industry to be involved. That is something that we're actively seeking and actively working towards. And I just want to thank everyone, all the training coordinators, all the subtask leaders and training community. If I showed you a picture of where I work, it's a car park outside. So, you know. So I worked for this was taken at the All Hands meeting in October last year, so you'll see some people in there. And I am happy to take any questions at all.
Thank you. Do you have any questions for Lisa?
How do you get people to answer to your surveys, especially for the long-term feedback?
Sorry, just keep emailing them. that has been quite tricky to actually get people to answer these surveys, because they get so many after every single course. What I tend to do is I send them three in total, three emails. I send one straight after the course, either that evening, unless it's a Friday, in which case I'll wait until the Monday. And within the email that I send them, I actually say to them, we want your answers, we will actively use your answers to help us continue to provide first-class training. We have on average 25 to 35 people attending each course. If we take 35 as the average top number, I get around 25 to 28 responses, which I think is not bad. But I do tend to ask again after about 3 days, and then after about a week, I'll ask them once more, and I will say, this is a final email for feedback, and then just leave it.
And for the long term, they might have moved on in their career to a different organization.
So what we do initially is we will use whatever email they send us, but I've recently, in the past month, I've rejigged our survey. And although I ask them for their email at the top of the survey, when I say, are you happy to be contacted for long-term feedback, yes or no, I then put a box saying, please put your email for long-term feedback. And you will find that if they know they may not be there in 6 months, they'll actually put their Hotmail account or Gmail account. I have bounce backs. I think I sent out 92 emails for long-term feedback, and I probably had about 10 that will bounce back, which can't really be helped, but I do put that box in.
I think it's really helpful to remind people that you're going to actually use their feedback. Mm-hmm. How many times do you get some sort of questionnaire and you never know what really is going to happen, if people are going to actually use it? So that's an important message to send.
I think what's interesting as well is those who give you bad feedback or not great feedback, they don't put in their name or their email, they will leave all that blank, and then they will write, I wasn't happy with this. And I think they're so scared that, you might be mean to them the next time they come in for training or something, when it's kind of, for me, I would rather the bad feedback left you the email and you could email them going, we fixed that, we've changed that, we've taken that on board, you know, we didn't realise that wasn't very good. Or some people complain that day two is far too fast for them. We've now changed that and we've taken aspects out and turned that, put that into an advanced course. I'd love to be able to get back to all those people and go, we've changed it, but they don't leave their emails. So, yeah, but we do. I mean, it is used.
Do you find that you have a little bit of a Yelp review phenomenon where people who do, they do leave their names, but they say, yeah, it was great, loved it, best course ever. And then other people, even if they leave their name or not, they just, if they have something negative to say, they just leave chapters worth of criticism. Do you find that kind of goes on a little
bit? Yeah, it is like that. I mean, there are some people who, it doesn't matter what the course is, they love it. I mean, we've had the same people attend quite a few courses, and they think it's the most amazing thing they've ever been to, but then in the same set of feedback, you'll get someone who'll say, I wasn't happy with that, I didn't like the content, it didn't do this. We've had other people say it was far too advanced for them because they didn't have the grounding of the introductory course that they never attended. So you kind of want to reply to them going, well, had you not cancelled the introductory course, you would have done fine on that one. But yeah, I think I've also been doing face-to-face interviews as well. So I've recently been to Edinburgh and conducted some face-to-face interviews there. I've done some in Cambridge. I'm hoping to go to Sweden in September and Italy in September as well. And it's really good to get people into a room on their own and chat to them about what their expectations were. Has it met their expectations? How does it compare to other courses? Is there anything they change? Is there anything they'd like to criticise? And I've only had positive people at the moment. But it is interesting when somebody's more relaxed and they know that you will actually use what they're saying, they are more open and they say things like, I wish that had been quicker, I wish that had been slower, I wish I'd had that information before it went in. Some of that could have been carried out online prior to the course. And it's quite interesting and it's quite useful. And I have all the surveys, if anyone wants a copy, if anyone wants to see what we ask, I've got links to all of them, and you can take copies and use them and develop them and do what you want with them.
That's great. Any other questions? Yes.
We talked about matching your training materials to competencies. Could you talk about your kind of mental procedure of doing that? Because at the TCC, especially for Aeronite, we're really interested in kind of discovering dependencies for replicate. And
so we're not matching the training materials, we're matching the courses, if that makes any sort of difference. It took four of us in a room a whole day to sit there with just a subset of about 30 courses and try to run through. And we haven't completed it by any means, but we went through and we tried to think about who would attend that course, why they wanted to attend the course, and what they would expect to get out of it. So things like we just had an NGS course. Is it an introductory course? If so, then you could have it, you could have someone attending it who's down there. If it's not an introductory course, you wouldn't want them to attend it, so you would want them to be a bit more advanced, maybe a group leader rather than a PhD student. And it was quite hard. And it's not something that I can kind of sit here and say, oh yeah, we just did that, and that was really good. You just have to break it down into what the course will provide and hope for the best. And I don't think by any means it's finished. I don't think that it's static. I think that it will change and we will add to it in the future. But it's not set in stone, so I wouldn't really want to talk about it too much.
We can talk a little bit about what's maybe some of the expectations of that might be when we have some of our working group stuff. So I think.